How can we compute a contour integral if the parametrization of the path is not specified? In that case, you will have to find the parametrization yourself. You will see an example in this video. And be careful, the integral may depend on the path, not just the endpoint, as you will also see in this video. So let's take as an example f of z over here, y minus x minus 3 x squared times I, and we'll integrate this function along c1 and along c2. And notice that the start points are the same, 0, and the endpoints 1 plus I are the same. So let's start with c1. Well, c1 consists of two parts, l1 and l2. Parametrization is not given, so we'll have to find it ourselves. But it consists of two lines. So first we parameterize l1, the first line, by z of t equals I times t, t between 0 and 1. Because if you do it like this, you get a line, and at t equals 0 you start at 0, and at t equals 1 you are at I, so you have a line with the correct endpoints. So if you write it down in x and y, you get x equals 0 and y equals t. So how do we compute the integral? Well, they go along L1 fdz, boundaries of t, 0 to 1. You get dz equals I times dt, and then you have to plug in the x equals 0 and the y equals t into your function f. So x equals 0, that's nice, because that means that those terms cancel out here. And y equals t means that you get a t over here. So the function you have to integrate is just t times I. So integrate 1 half t squared between the boundaries yields an I over 2. So that's the integral along L1. Let's continue with L2. Well, on L2 we have the upper line over there. So what do we do? The y is constant equal to I. The imaginary part is constant equal to I. And x varies between 0 and 1. So for x we take t between 0 and 1. So our parametrization will become t plus I. So the x equals t, y equals 1. Both x and y are real. Note. Then we compute the integral along L2 fdz. So t again between 0 and 1. And for the dz, you just get a dt, because that equals t plus I. What about the function? Well, we have to plug in x equals t and y equals 1 into our function over here. So we get a 1 minus t minus 3t squared times I, exactly what we have over there. And then you just have to integrate with respect to t, split up through an imaginary part. So integral 1 minus t dt minus I times 3t squared dt. So if you integrate the 1 minus t, you get a t minus 1 half t squared, which gives you 1 minus 1 half equals 1 half. And 3t squared, if you integrate, you get t cubed between 0 and 1, gives you a 1. So you are left with a factor minus I. So the integral, total integral along c1 is the contribution of the first part and the second part. So you get a 1 half minus I plus I over 2, so 1 half minus I over 2. So there you go. Okay, those line parts are, size segments are easy to parameterize. Let's take a look at the integral along c2, which looks a bit harder. Well, we can do over there. We have the line y equals x, so we can take x equals t and y equals t, and let t run between 0 and 1, like this. So that means that for our z we get t plus I times t. What do we get for our integral? Well, again, we chose our parameterization such that t runs between 0 and 1. The dz now becomes dt times 1 plus I, so that this part over here. And then we have to plug in x equals t and y equals t into our function over here. Ah, that's nice, because the real part cancels out, gives us a t minus t minus 3t squared times I. So what do we have left? You take out the minus I over here, you take out the 1 plus I over there, and then you just have to integral 3t squared dt, integral t cubed between 0 and 1 gives you a 1. So you're left with minus I times 1 plus I equals 1 minus I. So there you have your integral along c2. And in particular, you notice that the integrals along c1 and c2 are not the same.